So my name is Amara, and I've been involved with Lahakea community for about 13 years, and this is Tracy.
Hi, I'm one of the founding members, so I've been here for 16 years.
Yeah, so we're really happy to be here with all of you today, and I am going to do a little share screen. We have been having technical issues today, such as the power going out. But we managed to be here. Yay. All right, so let's get rid of that. Let's go over here. And let's see if Zoom will cooperate with me. It's not cooperating very well.
We did see the presentation before.
Yes, I know. I'm trying to reshape the screen so that all you see is that. I know that you can see our, here we go. This is what I want. This little box.
Great.
All right.
How's that?
Good?
Looks great.
Excellent. All right. So we are a permaculture community, and we live near a small town called Pahoa on the Big Island of Hawaii. And hang on just a second. And that's what I'm trying to do. Like I said, I couldn't really set this up very well before. All right. I'm hitting the arrow key and nothing's happening.
Okay. Well, while she's playing with that, I can talk to you a little bit. So we are completely off grid, hence our slight technological issues that happen frequently. So we are a community that you would be interested in joining if you are interested in the experiment and exploration of not always having access to technology. So it's a really good opportunity to have that little wake-up call of what does it mean to be integrated into the system. Out here, you get a great opportunity to disengage from that. In fact, cell phone signal is very wobbly, and oftentimes people that are wanting to make important calls or video conferences actually need to drive to town. But luckily that's only a 10-minute drive away, so it's not that big of a deal. But that said, this is a place to come if you're interested in how to live together with people and the land in a really close situation where sustainability with each other in our relationships and with growing our own food and having animals and systems like that, solar voltaic, solar thermal, catching rainwater, all that kind of stuff is happening here.
Yeah, it's a beautiful rural jungle lifestyle. So we've been together for about 16 years from the beginning. Formed from a small group of people that met each other at a Network for New Culture camp. I'm not sure if you've knows that group, but it's a group really interested in exploring creating new culture, creating new relationship structures. And they got together and decided to get a piece of land in Hawaii. So currently we're 10 adults and 2 children, and our children are around 13 years old right now. And we're born here. And so it's a very small and tightly knit chosen family. No, it's more like a family feeling than anything else. And we're very involved with each other, very involved with each other emotionally. And it's very supportive. As I said, we're living in a rainforest area of the Big Island of Hawaii, up at about 1200 feet. So it's very wet. It rains a lot, which means the plants look like this and things grow like crazy. You can watch some of the bamboo and the grass growing like an inch a day. And we're totally off the grid. So each of our buildings has its own solar system, if it has it at all, and we catch rainwater. Sometimes each of our buildings has its own rainwater catchment also, and then we filter it using the solar electric. And we've got about 24 acres of incredible lush jungle, including our permaculture farm. So our farm, how many acres do you think we have developed? Maybe 5 out of the 24?
Well, if we're talking about food,
yeah, and orchards,
at least I'd say probably 6,
maybe 6 acres, yeah. And so we have a big fenced garden, and we need to fence it because there's lots of things that want to eat our food, like wild pigs and chickens. So we fence in this huge garden, and we also build our own private houses, each of us. In the process, after we've joined the community, which takes a while, and we'll talk about that more later, we create our own housing, but we do share a common house and a kitchen.
Yeah, so one thing I want to point out about having our own houses is really we have our own structures for retreat. So typical considerations, people think of a house and they think, oh yeah, so you've got your bathroom and your kitchen and you have a house. Well, for us, it's more like you have a cottage or you have a cabin. And so we all have our little places that we go to sleep and if we want like a little retreat space. But other than that, the kitchen is at the main house. The showers are at the main house. The hot tub is at the main house.
Right. we have a library space and other, nobody lives at the main house. And also, we set up our own, like I said, solar systems in each cabin, and we have various, most of our, we don't have bathrooms, we have outhouses. So, and those are scattered around the land, and then we capture our humanure and let it ferment, and then we feed our trees with it. So we recycle everything we can in that way. We also keep smaller private gardens around each of our houses besides our large permaculture garden. And we do work parties 4 days a week in the morning for a few hours. And we expect our farm supporters to come to that. We encourage our members to come to that. But we don't require it. We don't require any particular amount of work from our members. However, we really value contribution. And so someone who really doesn't like to do anything, it doesn't work very well. Because there's a lot to do on a farm and also many human interactions things to happen also. So we're a group of people that really values contribution and good work ethic. And we also have chickens. And we've got a large enclosed yard for the chickens. How much do you think? Half an acre?
No, it's an acre. The first 5 years of community, we played keep the chicken out because we all had this great idea that we wanted to have free range birds. And so that became keep the human in. And so after the first 5 years, we decided to shift that. And for me, that's an example of what living here is like. It's like a daily experiment. So every day is like, how can we be more sustainable with each other in the land? And what can we do to nurture that kind of connection? So as time has gone by, definitely a lot of our systems have gotten a lot more dialed in, for sure. It's still that opportunity exists for the freshness and the newness for whatever happens to come along for us to get an opportunity to look at it. And together, because we do our decisions by consensus, figure out what we're gonna do.
Yeah, it's always an experiment, and if it doesn't work, we make it different. So we also have currently a couple of sheep. We used to have a flock of sheep, but then the volcano started going off, which is actually very close to where we live. And it was raining down little bits of fiberglass on our grass, and so we had to get rid of the sheep until the volcano decided it wanted to quiet down. So that's another thing about living in Pune is you have to be very adventurous.
Yes, and have a lot of let go.
But luckily our land was totally fine, even though there was lots of lava flowing about
mile away.
Yeah, maybe 3 miles away. Yeah.
Close.
It was that was exciting. That was in 2018. So here's our sheep, and they're kind of like pets. They take them for walks. And we also have fruit orchards. We've got a big citrus orchard with all kinds of oranges and lemons and grapefruits and a lot of bananas and many other kinds of trees that are too numerous to list, but lots of tropical fruit.
And so, like I've said several times, for us, it's a knowledge of permaculture, as well as having a large toolbox for communication and personal growth skills. So that's what we're looking for in people that want to become members here. The thing that we've learned is the most challenging part is relationship and being able to interface with each other. But you can't really interface with someone else if you can't interface with yourself. So a lot of it is being willing to own what's alive inside of you and look at that, because you can't dance. I mean, you can dance alone. What am I trying to say? Anyway, you get the idea.
Got to dance alone first.
Dance alone first, and then you can dance with others pretty well. So all of us have skills like peer counseling, NVC, compassionate communication, all different kinds of things.
Okay, go ahead. There we go. That's that slide.
Oh, that's that slide. Okay. So we also use Zeg Forum. That's actually how Network for Permaculture got established, was a group of people went and visited Zeg. It's a community in Germany. And then they decided to bring the ideals and a lot of the models back to the West Coast. And they meet every summer in Oregon. And now it's also on the East Coast and other places. And
we host it too.
Yeah, we host Winter Camp, which is a Network for New Culture event.
Had to miss this year, but hopefully we'll do it again next year.
Back to that one. Okay, so we're a partial income sharing community. So for those of you that don't know what that means that everybody has their own financial responsibilities and their own financial pieces. And then we also contribute a monthly fee to a common kitty. And from that common kitty, things like food, propane, land maintenance things, improvements, all that stuff comes from the common kitty. We have a buy list that we decide together about what the community is authorized to purchase. And if it's not on that list, you have to get approval to do so, or you have to buy it yourself. And so, yeah, that's what that looks. Currently, if you are a member, membership fees are $250 a month, but that's all inclusive.
Such a deal.
Yeah, we are an awesome model for low-income housing. To become a member, we ask for $35,000, but that is something that you can commit to over time. And we are fairly anti-interest. So that means that you get an opportunity to look at what your income is and how much you can afford to pay each month towards your equity.
Mm-hmm. So we also work together on group projects. We were having a lot of gatherings before COVID. We're planning on having them again. And this is a picture of one of them where we had a circle at a seed exchange we were doing. So local people saving their own seeds and then bringing them and trading them. And that's a lot of fun. It's one of our community contributions. And as I said, this is the meeting room in our common house where we have our indoor space with our wood-fired stove. So if we wanna do something warm and snuggly, we go into this room. And we have other large outdoor spaces also. So for meetings,
we have a heart chair once a week. That is a time where we come together in the evening after dinner and do different kinds of connective sharing, practicing authentic transparency with each other. Oftentimes it could be an extended check-in. It could look like some milling. It
could be massaging each other. It could be emotional processing, like helping people who are having conflicts that need the group support.
Yeah, we also have a weekly business meeting, and that takes about 2 hours once a week. And then we have daily check-ins, which are optional. You either show up or you don't. and we have 5 communal meals a week.
Yeah. So, and the communal meals, we take turns cooking them. So we each have a cook shift and a cleaning shift every week, and we are expected to show up for those.
And that's kind of cool because you get to cook once a week, but you get to eat 4 more times without having to do any of the work.
Right. And then the, you know, breakfasts and lunches are just from our own communal stash of food. Everybody comes in and makes their own. Now, when it's a large group of people, which sometimes it is, we have a lot of visitors and guests, then we have more shared cooked meals because our kitchen's too small to have 20 people come in and make breakfast all at once. Right.
And one thing you can also tell from this picture is living in Hawaii means that a lot of our living gets to be outside.
Right. This is our covered front porch on the main house. So one of the unusual and special things about our community is that we're very open to alternative relationship styles. So whoever you're loving is fine. However many people you're loving is fine. So a number of us are polyamorous, which means we're have open relationships that are above board. They're transparent. We talk about it. We aren't sneaking off to have affairs. We're like saying, well, I'm interested in this and what do you think? And we're negotiating sometimes with a number of people. There are some other people here who are not in any relationships or choosing to be monogamous. So we value all the different choices about autonomy and sexual.
And as we said before, we make our important long-term decisions by consensus. And for us, that is more than just what you might think of as important and long-term decisions. Many, many things are brought to the business meeting and everybody attends the business meeting. At least all the members do. And the members are the ones that make the decisions. And right now, as we said before, there are 10 members. So that means 10 people sitting in a room together with an agenda board and a facilitator. We rotate facilitation. So that's an important skill we want everybody to have. You don't know how to do that, you get to learn it. And then we talk about everything from
color of the kitchen walls.
No, we learned early on that that one needs to be subcommitted pretty quickly. We've learned that there are things that are better done as small groups or individuals and having let go, and that there are other things that we can work on together to figure out.
Yeah.
So it depends upon that. Aesthetics are usually subcommitted out. When we first started community, I think we spent a whole day discussing what color we were going to paint the kitchen wall.
It was a little much.
It was a little much, so we don't do that anymore. But other things like, you know, how are we going to improve the road? Or how many animals do we want to have on the land? If it's like looking at a big number, not just a couple more whatevers, that kind of stuff all comes to the meeting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and people that visit with us, you know, we talk about there. We allow people to come visit. We allow people to come do work trade, and we talk about that in meetings too. Like if people want to stay longer, we talk about how they're fitting in. Mm-hmm. And we all need to be a hell yes for them to stay longer than a month. We let a bunch of people come just for a month, but then we're a little more cheesy after that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so as it says, we own the land in common, and we all pay, each one of us pays a portion towards a buy-in or to have equity in the land when you become a member. And that helps us ensure authentic power balance. So like I said earlier, the buy-in is $35,000. It started off at $50,000, and we had that for quite a long time, but then we lowered it because we were feeling we're good. When people leave, you get a certain percentage of that back. In fact, you get most of it back.
We have it almost paid off. We don't have a bank loan.
Well, the land's paid off.
Yeah. So it's great. We don't have to pay anybody anything except, you know, property tax on our land. So that feels really great. But the buying in the on the land doesn't include building your own house.
No.
So when people are, you know, joining us, then they usually live in one of our extra houses. And we do have a number of little cabins and huts and places like that for people to stay. They stay in those for a while until we all decide that we're happy together.
Yeah. And so we intend to expand to somewhere between 12 and 15 or maybe more, but we don't know, full-time members, depending on what feels good, okay? The ways to come visit us, check it out, explore, you can come as a farm supporter, you can just come as a visitor. The difference between those two is a farm support requires a month-long commitment, and it requires that you're able and desiring to contribute to the hard work of living on a farm. And if that is not the category that you are in, then you're welcome to come as a visitor. Visitors pay a little bit more, but there's no work expectation for them. But you're also included in everything that's going on here. We are looking for new members, and the process to become a member is, of course, to come and live with us at first. Whether that's as a farm supporter or a visitor, we would want you to live with us for a minimum of a month. Before then, you could request to be a trial member. Trial members live with us for 6 months. And during that 6 month period, you're asked to participate in everything. You come to all the business meetings and the heart chairs. You participate as if you were a member. The only difference is in our consensus decision-making process, you're not allowed to block. And of course, another big decision, big difference is that if it's not working out and you're a trial member, we might ask you to leave. That's
right.
True too.
So when we do accept someone for membership, then they join the LLC that owns the land and they get on all of the papers. And we do have a process for asking someone to leave, or if someone chooses to leave, and giving them part of their money back. I think it's about 2/3 of the money back.
Yep, you get about 2/3 back.
Yeah. So if you want to check us out more, you can watch videos about us. We have a number of videos up at our website, permaculture-hawaii.com.